bang on 1 o'clock. I'm not sure when the formal date of Christmas salutation was actually given, but it's not yet. But in any case, given that this is our last meeting before Christmas, can I wish colleagues, officials, members of the public, and everyone else a very Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. Can we ensure that all phones are turned to silent, please? And can I remind members and presenters who are using the microphones, if you can be as close as you possibly can to them, so we can ensure that people in public gallery can hear us. Item one, apologies for absence.
Apologies from Councillor Grumwald, Jane Kennedy, Brandon Cannon, Rowden, Barbara Spicer, and Gideon
Bentley. Are there any further apologies? No. Item two is declarations. Any members' declarations? Item 3 is the minutes of the previous meeting that was held on 17th November 2017, and they are included in the Acts from 1, page 1 to 14. And I ask if these are agreed to.
Agreed.
Item 4. Unfortunately, we start this week with the worrying news that Palmer and Harvey have gone into administration nationally, and locally that's having consequences on their depot at Haydock, which is closed with the loss of potentially 200 jobs. And I'm sure that ourselves as a combined authority, working with St Helens Council, with local MPs, with trade unions, and with the staff, will do all that we can to possibly mitigate that sad situation. Last month I met with the Chancellor, and he delivered, as we know, a budget which included a number of things that are relevant to the Liverpool City region. I set out a vision for the Liverpool City region on the 14th of November with a series of asks from government on the likes of transport, on homelessness, on infrastructure and skills. So I was pleased that some of the issues that we asked for have been addressed. Certainly with the announcement of £134 million in transport in our city region, we've also got a share of £28 million in the Housing First funding package, which we are one of three pilot areas to tackle homelessness. And we also welcome the Chancellor's commitments to work with us to explore further devolved powers, although we haven't yet decided on the extent of those. However, conversely, I'm disappointed that other key aspects, including greater local control of the apprenticeship levy funding, not being granted, and there's still no commitment to potentially transformational Crossrail for the North, which we've all banged on about, but is probably pivotal to the fortunes of the whole London corridor. So, on balance, it was a budget, I believe, of missed opportunities from the government, and the Chancellor should have done much more to support economic rebalancing, stimulate growth and revive our cash-strapped public services. And it was far from what the government labelled it as being, which was a game-changing budget. I think we all promised that to the government. On the 26th of November, I was very fortunate at the unveiling to be present at the unveiling of a commemorative plaque donated in memory of the late campaigner Anne Williams and their family, which is a tribute to all the survivors and those people trying to save lives on that fateful day. It's situated in Liverpool Central Station, where literally hundreds of thousands of people on an annual basis pass through. So hoping that people will take a look at the time, go and have a look at that. But a very poignant, I think, introduction onto our transport system. And as part of commitment that I made to make certain we have an inclusive city region and that I get out as much as possible, I spent a day of community engagement in St Helens, as well as meeting the leader of the council, obviously Barry Grumwald, to discuss all the issues that councils are facing. I visited the Hope Centre, which offers a range of employment, language and skills support, food bank, and visited the YMCA to meet staff and service users to discuss how the funding that we receive, the budget, to adopt that housing first approach to homelessness might be best used certainly to get the biggest impact. And Professor Jana Beers just walked in, which is opportune because last week an invitation from her as the UK President of Vice Chancellors. I gave a keynote speech to an audience of Vice Chancellors, I think it was about 100, 150 Vice Chancellors from around, and senior academics from around the country. And as well as discussing how I believe that the universities can play a deeper, more integral role in driving economic growth, certainly in areas like ours, certainly working with the new developed structures in the English city regions. I also challenged some of the disproportionate funding that goes into what's called the Golden Triangle, people will know, which is Oxford, Cambridge and London. And I also argued that our higher education sector must become more connected, more innovative, and more entrepreneurial, and cited some of the fantastic work that our universities, not just Liverpool University, but John Moores and Hope, what they're doing to help shape the region's economy. And finally, on Tuesday, I attended the inaugural Mayor's Summit, which was hosted by the Centre for Cities, this was in London, and it brought together six of the UK Metro Mayors, and a counterpart from similar sized areas in the United States. And it was a series of discussions, and certainly it was about relationship building between us. But Greg Clark, who's the Secretary of State, attended that as well. And it was a really fantastic opportunity for our city region to highlight the successes, but also to lay best practice from what's happening around the globe. And let me tell you that just because that thing comes from the bad says in Liverpool, the city region, it opens so many doors and opportunities for us, which is, as I said in the past, much more preferable to the Nokia Holton, the Bulls and Telling sector, and the work of the Bad Authority and the world. And just two quick notes, we're about to commission a piece on digital connectivity, as I mentioned in the keynote speech that I made in November. And on a really positive note, Liverpool City Region was awarded the Combined Authority of the Year at the recent Transport Awards event in So again, success quite rightly, I think, from certainly all of the leaders and the deputy mayor. We have to pass on our congratulations to all the staff who were involved in achieving that award. Item 5 is the Liverpool City Human Skills Strategy. It's our first report of the day, and we know we're improving skills, it's fundamental to a lot of our growth, helping people into work and improving our productivity. So Sue Jarvis is going to take us through that report. Sue.
Thank you, Chair. The cover report for the strategy document sets out the evidence base that we've used to pull together this draft of the skills strategy, and just as a quick reminder, it builds on the work that the Combined Authority did last year with the post 16 area based review. It also plays in the findings from our skills survey of employers that we undertook during the summer months, where we have responses back from over 1800 employers. We've had a whole series of workshops with key stakeholders and employers over the last few months, and we've also had input from the Skills Commission and a review of the labour market's information. So a lot of information has gone into this draft, and just before it was published, the government produced the industrial strategy, so we've had a read across there as well to make sure that we can line up what we're trying to do with the national picture. So just very briefly, sorry, what we've tried to do in terms of how we've positioned the strategy, it's very much about turning challenges into opportunities. So the evidence is telling us that we have, within the city region, there's a strong potential for growth in key sectors. We know that productivity is above national rates in our key sectors, and there are jobs out there that are demanding the higher level skills. But this is not uniform across the city region. So that's something that we need to be mindful of in some of the actions we have in the strategy moving forward. employment growth and replacement demand due to an ageing workforce, these sit alongside each other in terms of the need to increase skills and employability. We know that our labour supply is likely to grow much more slowly than in other city regions due to the demographics of this area. But we've also got the uncertainty around Brexit as well that may have an impact on future growth rates. So these are other factors that need to be played into the document itself. We've also got from the Employee Skills Survey evidence of skill shortages and local recruitment problems that need to be tackled. There's a clear need to reduce inactivity levels within the city region. We know that we've got 130,000 of our residents who are inactive, and of those, around 100,000 are on sickness benefits. We also know there's a need to narrow skills and employment gaps for certain sections of our population and to address poverty both in work and out of work, particularly around wage levels. So what this gives us within the strategy is that opportunity to not only restructure our economy, but also upskill and employ our people. However, to do this, we know that we need to change the skills system. There needs to be a step change because it is particularly fragmented, as I will come on to in a minute. So the slide you've got here, what I've tried to do is really summarise the framework. So this is very high level. What we have done with the strategy is built on the ambition that's set out in the single growth strategy. And what we are trying to do is use the skills strategy to act as a bridge between two key pillars. The first one being the need to work for our employers in creating the workforce of tomorrow with high level and appropriate skills. But it must also work for all groups of people across the city region. We must strive to have inclusive growth embedded within this strategy. So we have five key delivery outcomes that are laid out in the middle column, but we also have a sixth outcome that is very much about what we want to do to change our skills system. And I'll just spend a minute just going through each of the outcomes. In terms of the first outcome, we're looking here for a high percentage of our young people to have good attainment in maths, English and digital skills, but also to have high levels of work readiness. And this has come through from the findings of the employer survey, but also if you look at the statistics, the attainment levels for GCSE 16-year-olds at level 2, we've not closed the gap in the city region with regional and national rates. So what that means in effect, our young people at 16 spend the time between 16 and 19 catching up, getting a level 2 qualification, when in other areas 16-year-olds will be going on to get a level 3 qualification and the technical skills that employers want. So we've got that lag that we have to catch up with. By the time we get to 19, by and large we've caught up, but we do lose a few years there, so we need to look at what we can do about that. Outcome two is very much about how we have a higher proportion of the working age population actually in employment, but also in good quality and higher paid jobs. And I've already mentioned the inactivity rates that we have in the city region. And just as an example, if we were to match the Northwest inactivity rate, we'd have 34,000 more people in jobs, in work, in the city region at this point in time. Outcome three focuses very much on our growth sectors, and what we're looking for here is higher productivity and a lower incidence of skill shortages within the growth sectors. Outcome four is more broadly about how we tackle recruitment difficulties across the piece in all sectors, and particularly how we address the issue of replacement demand. We know there will be in the region of 240,000 jobs that will need to be filled over the next 10 years due to replacement demand. And if I just give you a comparison, that compares to around 75,000 jobs that would come from growth strategies. So it's a big number of replacement demand that we need to look at. Outcome five is very much focused on our employers It's not all about public money, this strategy. We need to work with our employers to up the level of investment into skills and training. And we know from the employer skills survey that fewer than one in five of the employers who were surveyed were actually invested in training at this point in time. And then finally, the sixth outcome is very much about changing the system and challenging the system to be simpler, to join up more, for there to be more collaborative behaviours both within the city region, but then also in terms of how we challenge back nationally to government. There are a whole range of actions that are flagged up in the document that you've got with your papers. What we have tried to do over the 5-year period of the strategy is to try and focus on a small number of critical actions, because we can't do everything, so we've got to narrow down what collaboratively we're trying to do. So this slide really gives you some of the building blocks to do this, and if I just use outcome one as an example, one of the second bullet point on outcome one is talking about how to address some of the issues around detainment for young people, that we work with the careers system more and how can we get more effective careers information, that advice and guidance, particularly through the careers hub, which was an Ask About Devolution Agreement, and how do we put that now back to the industrial strategy that wants to pilot a small number of careers hubs in city regions. So we're already ahead of the curve on that one. How do we just sort of land that one and get the pilots in our area? One other point just to make on this though, and one of the challenges I've had when I've talked about the strategy with partners, is the building blocks are all well and good, but how do we actually achieve that step change? So what we also need to make sure we do is hook up into some of the big aspirational projects that we have as a city region, whether that's the tidal power, digital connectivity, and other examples, but we do need to do that aspect as well. In terms of the skills system itself, this warrants, unfortunately, this warrants a full slide, and that's because the employment skills system is highly fragmented and centralised. There's different agencies, different programmes, different funding streams, different groups of people being served, different rules, and nationally there's no common plan. So what we're trying to do here in the Liverpool City region is knit all of that together, but it's not an easy task. So one of the challenges back to all of us is how we work harder to create that system in the city region that is much simpler to access for individuals, for employers, but also for service providers. Aligned to that, we need to work to strengthen our employer engagement. We've got some good examples of that, but again, it's not across the piece. We need to promote and highlight role models, particularly if we're looking to raise aspirations and participation for certain sections of the community. We know we need to do more around work placements and work experience for our young people. We need to have a more personalised delivery particularly for those who are furthest away from the labour market. How do you help people with complex needs get back into the system? Most importantly, we need to build on what works, and we need to focus on what needs to improve. And you'll notice in the document itself, we've got some examples of some case studies from within the city region where we know we have good practice and things are working well, and we want to celebrate those within the strategy. We also need to make sure we have the right research and intelligence to drive the commissioning decisions that we will be doing once we have the adult education budget devolved to the city region in 2019-20. And we also need to make sure that we link up all the various complementary roles that different partners have in delivering this strategy, and that will be one of the actions moving forward. So just finally, in terms of the next steps, following on from today, a final consultation period, particularly to focus on the actions and the implementation. That will run until the 15th of January. We'll continue to do some cross-referencing with the industrial strategy, and the government's careers strategy was actually launched this week, so we'll look at that document as well. We need to finalise the key performance measures for the strategy. We've posed that as one of the questions as part of the consultation document. And then, all being well, we intend to bring back the final version to the Command Authority at the February meeting. And as part of that, we then may want to start thinking about if there are future devolution asks that are required in order to help deliver the aspirations in the strategy itself. So I shall pause there and happy to take any questions.
And so, Councillor May, you've obviously been excellent in this strategy forward. Have you got anything to add?
No, Chair, except to say that the survey is really important. It's a good one we have to do, that's reaching out to our employees and tell them what they actually need. The area based review was another milestone for us where we got, for the first ever time, we got some level of influence on the strategies and capital strategies of our college providers. And the discussions in that process went well, it may, and that helps us drive ourselves forward. Because we need to do something about skills. I mean, we've been talking about this as long as I can remember. We need to do something about skills, and we need to be able to give our providers the confidence that when we give them a direction. And one of the reasons for this being a draft strategy coming here today is because of the processes. They get an understanding of the direction that we're going on with this particular skill strategy. That's why a draft one's here for that. But we need to be able to give them the confidence that they can deliver what we want them to deliver, what our employers want them to deliver, what our people that need the skills need them to deliver. Because, you know, they are businesses, they have to plan ahead, and we have to give them the tools to be able to plan ahead. And this strategy is part of that toolkit to enable them to plan ahead alongside of us, alongside our employees, whilst dissecting the information we've got from the skills survey and the conversations that are going on with the input of all partners, including the Employment Skills Board, which is a subgroup of this combined authority and also of the LEM. So these are all important building blocks that we need to be able to give people direction and an understanding of how they get on this bus, wherever they stop it, whether you're an employer, whether you're a provider, whether you are a person who needs those skills. Where you get on that bus is the right bus stop for you, and where you get off is the right bus stop for you. So it's a really important strategy, and we need to just make sure that we can do our best to get it right.
We all agree that this is essential for the Command Authority and for the private sector, which you mentioned, and I mentioned providers and everybody else, but for the private sector, the feedback we're getting is that there's a real need to better align our supply with the demand that's forecast in the next few years. And at the moment, it's not quite as sync as we'd like it to be. Any other questions? Yeah, certainly, Councillor Lawson.
Thank you, Mayor. Obviously from St Helens, we welcome this initiative. I also take the opportunity of thanking you, Steve, for your support for Parliament Harvey, the workforce there. That's a classic example of the importance of transferable skills. A workforce who's accustomed to working on one sort of vehicle for distribution, then applying for work with Sainsbury's, work on a much bigger platform, and the need for those transferable skills to be inherent in our vocational sector is absolutely key. But thank you very much for your support and ongoing struggles to try and sort that out. Thank you.
Any further questions? Can we agree the recommendations are set out on page 15? We agree. Item 7 is the report which seeks approval to fund a revised programme of works for years 4 and 5 of the Silver Jubilee Bridge major maintenance scheme at a cost of £2.2 million. And needs from Head of Paid Service, Frank Rogers, will take us through this report.
Thank you, Chair. As detailed, the intent behind the report is to seek approval and to seek endorsement of the recommendation from the Transport Advisory Group for the CA to agree to funding £2.2 million for Silver Jubilee Bridge. It important to note that the funding is from LGF 1 pot and it's part of what was originally devolved majors transport fund. So strictly speaking, there's a separate assurance framework to the SIF assurance framework, and Silver Jubilee is the project in there that the TAG members have identified as the one that's most suitable for allocation of the existing non-allocated funding from that particular pot. In December of 2015, the SAA approved Silver Jubilee for delivering maintenance works on Silver Jubilee Bridge over a 5-year period. It approved the first 3 years of funding, and the intent was at that point in time to be a further request to go back at a later point to look for some further funding for years 4 and 5. We're currently in year 2 of the programme, and as part of the works undertaken to date, it's been identified that there's some previously unforeseen works that are necessary on superstructure for the bridge that are going to require additional funding. And so, in consideration of that, the report came forward to TAG asking for the allocation of the LGF1 unallocated funding. The timeliness of this, with the Mersey Gateway crossing opening and now Silver Jubilee being closed for a period of 12 to 15 months, means that the unforeseen elements of work can be prioritised in the process and can be undertaken in a cost-effective and efficient way, given all of the work that's currently in place in respect of scaffolding, road closures, and other activities that enable the work that's necessary and defined within this report to be undertaken. If it's not completed within the current closure period, there would be additional costs over and above the 2.2 million that's asked for. The benefit-cost ratio of the project remains unchanged. So it has a BCR of 4.06, so it's a strong project and a positive business case. And the report was further recommended to the LEP board on the 30th of November, and the LEP board has also provided its support to the project. So in conclusion, we're asking the combined authority to approve the proposal for 2.2 million of LGF1 growth fund to be allocated Silver Jubilee Bridge, using the change control process as part of the assurance framework within LGF1 to undertake works that is in superstructure for Silver Jubilee. So I refer you to the recommendations of section 2. I'm happy to take any further questions.
Before I take any questions, because I know Councillor O'Byrne will be pleased about this, I'll just for people who didn't understand all the acronyms used, obviously the LEP is the Local Enterprise Partnership, the SIF is the Single Investment Fund. The Local Growth Fund is LEP, LGF, and the TAG is the Transport Advisory Group. So that was the four that I picked up. I'm not sure whether there's any other ones that we've missed. Councillor Robinson, do you have anything else to add?
I'll try to avoid any but in fact, I think it's important we always remember how important an asset the Silver Jubilee Bridge is for connectivity across the city region. Obviously, the existing works have indicated additional works need to be done. It's not just cost effective to do that during the existing closure. It's actually really important that we do it now, so it doesn't lead to further kind of disruption closures in the future, which will just cause more problems with the use of the bridge and getting there in the city region.
Any questions? No? Can we agree
around
everything?
Sorry,
you
Again, just I think for public clarity, the question I did ask at the last meeting last week regarding how does the risk of benefits and why are we putting the funding in them, bear in mind, not too distant future, it could be in talk, but I think people need to understand that.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Okay, thanks,
Councillor Ballhead.
Just to
clarify,
the
funding
is I think it's necessary to understand that effectively the Silver Jubilee Bridge isn't part of the Mersey Gateway contract as such. The Silver Jubilee Bridge is part of the Halton Road network, so this is a road scheme in some sense. The mechanisms that are in place on the Silver on the Mersey Gateway contract are such that should there be any service revenues accrued on that particular scheme, there will be no recovery of those revenues for Halton Road Council for the first 16 years of the contract. So at the moment, there is no facility for Halton to generate funding from the existing Mersey Gateway Bridge to deliver this element of work. It is part of the road network in Holton. It's not an element of the Mersey Gateway project.
Sorry, any further questions? No, can we agree the recommendations are set out on page 51, please? Item 7, this report seeks the approval for two full business cases submitted for funding to the Single Investment Fund. The two cases are Paddington Village, which is listed today, which is phase one, and the Advanced Manufacturing Engineering Training Centre. And again, Frank's going to take us through this report.
Thanks, Chair. And I will refer to the Single Investment Fund and not SIF and the Northwest Training Corps, not the network of UTC. Background to this is that following the CA's initial, four to six projects came forward with strategic outline case submissions, and we're invited to progress the next stage of the process. We have two of those projects in front of us today. First one is Paddington Village, and the ask of the combined authority is for grant award to a maximum value of £12 million for Paddington Village Phase 1. Stick with that one and deal with that one in the first instance. As the Chair has just pointed out, this is a project that's currently on site. It has started, so the deliverability of this project is very strong. The benefit cost ratio associated with this project is 30, so it's a very strong project from a benefit cost ratio perspective. All the details associated with the assessment are included in Appendix 1 to the report, so more than happy to pick up any questions that there may be in relation to the Paddington scheme. Moving on to the second project, the Northwest Training Council project. This is for the relocation of the existing facility from Dunningbridge Road to a new site in North Liverpool. This is funded through the skills capital element of the local growth fund version one. The criteria associated with this project are more geared around retaining the facility to provide service provision to apprentices rather than overall job creation and GBA growth. So you could look at the project as not having a great value for money if you look at it from job creation and from a GBA perspective, but the premises are currently deemed not to be adequate for the ongoing provision of training from an advanced manufacturing perspective. There are some structural problems there, there are some roof leakage problems. The concern is that should there not be an alternative facility, that the current organisations that are using the existing premise may not be prepared to send their apprentices there for the future. Also key within this particular project is an upgrading of the equipment and the facilities that are in place within the existing premise, because at the moment they are, a number of them are over 10 years of age, and there is a concern that it will not have the capability to deliver the advanced manufacturing element that the apprentice schemes require. So overall, the view of the appraisers is that the deliverables have been appropriate for the level of funding that's being sought, and that if the project can be delivered within 2 years of approval, it's recommended, subject to the conditions that are detailed at 2.9. This has a BCR of 2.13, and again, I've recommended or put forward recommendations in section 2 to the combined authority, and I'm happy to take any questions.
I mean, nearly got away with it, except for BCR, benefit cost ratio. Gross value rather. Okay, we'll have to try and make this less impenetrable for people who don't understand TLA's three-letter acronyms. Just create that one. Okay, are there any questions on those two schemes? Councilor Mayor.
On the second one. £3 million again for the North West Training Centre. Are we confident that a net impact of 8 jobs, 3 million, is enough of an impact for us? expand on that a little bit more, how we come to the decision that this is valid for money?
Absolutely, yeah. Thanks,
yeah. Thanks, Councillor Martin. I think that's the point I was trying to get across earlier on. This is a scheme that's more about ensuring that the future of the training provision is there, rather than the additional creation of jobs or GVA. It's skills capital funded, and as such there is an employment element to the assessment of benefit cost ratio, rather than job creation and gross value added creation associated with that. So the job numbers aren't huge, but the concern is that if they don't relocate, if they don't upgrade the facilities, they won't be in a position where they will be able to provide a contemporary trainer in a few years' time. And it's that's the key driver within the support for the project.
If I can just follow up to that, Chair, are we confident that we're not setting a precedent for relocation of other businesses?
I think the approach that's been adopted is specific to this particular project. I don't think we're going to be able to say that we've set a precedent, because each and every situation is taken on its individual merits, and so this isn't a precedent-setting decision, if you agree with it today. This is one individual proposal that I think stands on its own. Other proposals then need to come forward and be considered at an appropriate point in time.
Any further questions? I think we very much get the point, Councillor Mayor, and it's something that we need to consider as well for future allocations. Can we agree the recommendations are set out on page 59 then, please? Item 8 is a portfolio update. Councillor Fuller Hall is going to take us through a presentation which sets out the work achieved within his portfolio of energy renewables.
Centred on Liverpool terminals. hydrogen fuel transport is a future opportunity. You could say hydrogen's on the up. The city region is well placed to exploit, given the, our assets in it and our expertise of our businesses in this field. We are generating a renewable energy in the city region. All councils secured EU funding for a scheme connecting solar farm to Winter Stadium. This will be completed in December next year. This approach could be taken to other low value sites across the city region. This particular site is Sandwich High and Sandwich High, you never get any on it. But it comes with a solar farm which will help us to generate electricity. And we can find ways, which we're working on now, to host the power, the storage electricity. This will become big in the future. City region has assets that use natural waste resources. We convert food, rubbish, and food into energy. Taking wood as an example, we import it into Septon, we convert it to solid fuels in Dorfley, we generate the energy from it in Halton, and many of our leisure centres are also to be located in this way. Public estate can lead by example on energy. £2 million has been spent in devolved skills on energy in further education colleges across the city region. A particular interested project at Willow College this year will see heat and power generated and stored on site. This will pay back quite quickly and then save considerable money for the college going forward. Sticking with the public realm, it's in Tallinn led a European project to innovate in low energy street lighting. All our boroughs are picking up on this and converting their lighting to LED. If we'd have got together in the beginning on that, we'd have saved huge amounts of money just by being economies of scale. Green growth is a trend that's here to stay. There are jobs in low carbon energy economy. And for example, 150 companies operating out of all six boroughs have won contracts to support the offshore wind industry. Our expertise extends also outside the region. This success could be repeated in other areas such as hydrogen storage and tidal energy if we focus our efforts and act quickly. Looking forward to 2018 and beyond, an energy strategy will be in Sweden, which will be brought before the government authority in spring next year. This will be not just to the energy and renewable portfolio, but highlight the city region's current strength and future opportunities, map out some potential routes to the most aspirations of the city region to be zero carbon, recommend actions to be implemented in the short and medium term, and recommend ways to integrate other CA portfolios. I'm happy not to take any questions, but technical ones, Mark, Golden Day, and
thanks, Ed. That's all. Any questions for Rob? Sometimes things are green and renewable energy and all that, it's a bit hippie. Some people think that it's just about, you know, Lendlease and all that sort of stuff. And just to dispel all those myths, it's not just about environmental considerations, it's also now, I think, it's an economic imperative for the city region. And with what we've got with Bearable Bank, which you mentioned, with solar stuff, with hydrogen capture, with the potential for harnessing the power of the River Mersey, we genuinely can become Britain's energy coast. And this is where the architects of devolution ensure that we've got the River Mersey as part of that devolution agreement. And I think in the years ahead, that's really going to create a difference for us. Thanks very much for that, Rob. Can we note the presentation, please? 9 is